companies and job executives from several companies. My name is John from the review. I'm substituting for the head of the steering committee, the organizing committee of the group, John Kosadin, Professor Kosadin, who is not here today. He will join us later. This is just a very brief announcement to thank you all for coming. I know that more people will be joining as the day goes on, and I've already informed our speakers that they might have people joining at all times during the presentation, so that's one word of the positive. It's a great pleasure to have a lot of prominent speakers on this particular day, and it's my personal pleasure to have two speakers starting the day from the tourism industry, which is my background. So, may I welcome you all, thank you for being here, and I will ask Sofia Topalou, the President of the Tourism and Hospitality Society, to introduce our first speakers. Thank you very much, I hope you enjoy the day.
Hi, good morning to all. My name is Sofia Topalou, as I said, Dr. Pagir, you said. I'm the President of International Tourism and Hospitality Management. Today, I have the honor to introduce Mr. Yannis Petrakis. Mr. Petrakis studied Hotel Management and Food and Beverage at the Appliance Center, and went to study for postgraduate diploma in tourism and accommodation studies and a master's in international hotel management at the University of Surrey in the UK. I know some of these things are for his career are not in the right order, but I hope that you will get the correct picture. Mr. Petrakis started his career as a commercial director of International Routes and Airlines Superfast Joint Service, and eventually became the commercial director for an airline's SA. His career continued in Hilton, first as business developer and management manager at the Hilton Villa Moura. After studies in Portugal and then as director of corporate sales and director of sales at Hilton Athens. His expert business is setting up new establishments and operations, including an ex-superfast joint service, Hilton Villa Moura, Hilton Athens, Sofitel Athens Airport, Regus Athens, and UPS Athens. Throughout his career so far, has received several recognition awards. Today, Mr. Petrakis is the Company Director of Sales and Marketing in Starwood Hotel Zeros in Costa, Navarino. Thank you all for being here, and please welcome Mr. Petrakis.
Hello, everybody. It's great to have you here and be here. I'm very honored to have this audience. This early morning on Wednesday. I hope it's a good break for your studies. So, I have prepared a good presentation to share some knowledge and discuss with you. So, questions will follow at the end if you wish to have them. My idea was to have a brief agenda to cover these 30 minutes. As you see, allow me to have a small introduction about who we are and where I come from. Then, we'll speak about the modern environment. What means life moves faster forward, how this affects the next working generation, and how this affects the travel and tourism industry, the industry that we are working in, plus what we believe in Starwood will be the solution to this new world that we face. So Starwood Hotels and Resorts, very quickly, this is one of the top three hotel companies and corporations in the world. More than 1,100 hotels in almost 100 countries. We're talking about 170,000 people working power, and we have 9 internationally known brands, namely the Top Notch and Ricci, the Luxury Collection, the Trendy W, Sheraton, the Westins, Elements, Aloft. These are the 9 brands of Starwood. In Greece, we are present with 11 properties already, and we keep continuing searching for new properties. We have properties in Athens, with properties in Rhodes, in Costa Navarino, in Crete, in Mykonos, and in Santorini. Namely, we have 3 brands in Greece, the Sheraton in Rhodes, we have 8 luxury collection brands, one of them is in Costa Navarino, and we have also the 2 Western hotels, one in Aster and one in Costa Navarino. Let me give you a slide about Costa Navarino because there is a confusion sometimes in our eyes. Costa Navarino is not a hotel. It's a destination. It's an area. Actually, it's a development of the great man of the late Captain Vassilios Kostadakopoulos, who wanted to really make an investment for his area, Messinia, and improve the quality of life there. So this is an area that has a number of things included, like the two hotels of Starwood, like two championship golf courses, a great congress hall, shops, residents will be starting building in a while. It's an area focusing on the environmental sustainability. So it's an area that I think Greece should be proud of. Starwood has two hotels there in this area. One is the luxury collection, branded Hotel de Romanos, with 320 rooms, 128 rooms with a private swimming pool. These hotels, the luxury collection hotels, are very special hotels of Starwood. Usually, we combine them with historical aspects, and they are hotels with quality, with excellent quality of service and facilities. And we have 85 hotels like this in the world. Romanos is one of them. In order to give you an idea, you can see a view from the lobby of Romanos. As you see, it's spectacular over the Ionian Sea. Allow me to show you a very brief video just to give you an idea of what we're talking about. Superfoods brand that we have in our hotels. We have about running games. We have about a lot of things that have to do really with how the family and the personal health style is united and comes to a brand which is called Westing, or indigenous way of life. So this is a view of the lobby, and let me show you also a very similar video for the Westing. Analyze our team go about the complexity of Navarino. Thank you. first a brief introduction of where I come from. Thank you for taking the time to see that. Let's get to the juice of our topic today. When I was invited by Mrs. Ovalo and Mr. Magherdio and Ms. Gabriel to take this speech about the life in Fast Forward, I was really amazed about the topic, and my mind went almost instantly to a book that I had read some years ago. The book is called The Future Shock. This book was written from the so-called futurist at the time, Mr. Alvin Toffler. He was a bestseller in his times. And he was describing the effect of having too much information in too short of a period of time. And actually, Alvin Toffler was going a step further, predicting that this future shock will create a continual suffering from anxiety, insecurity, uncertainty about their lives. Well, I was always wondering if Alvin Toffler was right or how right he was. And actually, trying to consider our discussion today, I found a nice video that I really fancy, that I hope you'll fancy as well, and we'll talk about discussion. Probably the film, it's a quite long video.
Thank you.
very interesting. In fact, sometimes statistics are very interesting and quite scary. Some of the points mentioned there are quite scary. But what all this means finally? I'm afraid to say that poor old Alvin Toffler, he was right. The future shock is already here, in one or the other way. We live with it. We have created the future shock, and it's among us, or we are within it. So what are we going to do about this? Certainly, technology advancement has created a lot of facilitation in our life. Our everyday life has become easier in many aspects, no doubt about this. But of course, there are certain aspects that are also needed, and apparently, we were not prepared to deal with it. Our life, as the leader says, we live in exponential times. The world is internalized, more complex, more unpredictable. Who could imagine, for example, that a writer will feel the need to write a book and create a philosophy about predictability? Who could imagine that we will read a book about Locke's Swan effect? Dr. Darren did that 5 years ago. So, in practicality, that means that we handle a more complicated life, that we have to do many more things at the same time. We have to accept that our working and personal life will be affected, and of course that the world is shrinking with all this technology advancement. We create this globalization that we are talking about. And this is why we have a question. How we created this future shock, and what was the result? Because the future shock is a result of our actions. We had some scientists that they followed their dream to make the world better, and they succeeded, great job. But at the same time, apparently, we did not prepare ourselves for the subsequent effects of this future shock we would create. In chess, which is a nice game, when we do a move, we always predict, we try to predict what will be the damage to the opponent, but also what will be the damage to ourselves, what we will suffer in order to gain a further move versus the opponent. Apparently, we're not so good chess players in this game. Albert Einstein said even better. We can solve our problems by using the same kind of thing we use when we create. Very wise thought. So what do we need to do? Definitely we need to adapt. Otherwise we'll stay behind. We need to be creative. I will share with you a study that I read 1 month ago, apparently. It was an interview of 1,500 chief executive officers in the US and Europe. And the main question was, what are the main traits or characteristics that the future leaders will need to be successful? And I was surprised to read that the number one trait, more than 80% of the answers, was creativity. Initially I was surprised, but then when I read the logic, it made sense. The people were saying, listen, with the technology advancement we have in our days, and with the structural procedures, the strict ones that the corporations, the national firms had, all the employees and associates of the firm, they work in the same manner, within the borders of the system and the machines they have. So we lose the creativity factor, which is so important to differentiate your product and your way of management versus your competition. So to have people with creativity inside leading companies of such size is very important in order to manage better, motivate better your people, design better your products, and we can gain market share in the market. So, definitely be creative. Multitasking. We have to be multitasking. In the past, the jobs were very straightforward, one or two tasks. Now, a manager can have 10, 15 tasks, projects running at the same time. And you have to deal with them. Of course, don't confuse what I'm saying with the ordinary working principles that there still exist. For example, the old saying, one step at a time is wise, should continue. But now you have 10 projects, so you have to take one step at a time for each project, and you have to do it at the same period. So be part of the change. This is very, very important, especially for older generations, starting from my age and above, but also for young people, because the way we think will help us to succeed or not succeed, will help us to keep the pace or not keep the pace. If you manage to put yourself available to help making the change, it's completely different from just following it. From just being negative anyway. So try to make yourself available. Try to find ways to be part of these change by contributing with the change. Because if you contribute in the change, you feel part of this team that makes the change. And then you're motivated, and then you enjoy your working life much better. And of course, in order to do that, you have to challenge your capacities, your sanities, your values. you have to get out of your comfort zone in order to be able to do that. And I know it's really challenging, it is, but believe me, it's all about handling. Talking about handling, let's see how now this future soil we created has really affected our working environment. And in a way, we ended the business as usual so far. And for this, my mind comes to this book, a very famous bestseller as well, written by Brian Solis. Brian was born in 1970, by coincidence, when the other guru, the futurist, Stanley Kotler, wrote the previous book. So this guy, he wrote in detail how the digital revolution affects the business world and the consumers. And actually, he's very strict in a way in what he says, because he believes that the companies either they will adapt to the new environment or they will die. It doesn't leave something gray in the middle. It's either black or white. Very interesting. Let's see if he's right and how right he is by showing you a very smaller video this time.
Thank you.
against Deree, Phoenix, and some concern. Well, you can see here more data, more things, more impressive situation, but also the acceleration of pace of the change. In any case, I mean, just think of the iPad, it was introduced first time in 2010, and now in 2013, end of the 2013 November, we have the tablet, the iPad. So it's, we are living in an era of a great change. So how this affects the situation? We introduced the picture shock with our actions, we ended the business as usual. Let's see what does this mean for our working environment. So working life is it's affected dramatically for millions of people around the world. Mobile and digital technologies have penetrated our lives, our personal and business lives, and the way we communicate, the way we work, and organize ourselves. People, of course, become more mobile. It's not by accident that the companies spend lots of money for mobile marketing. Okay? You saw in the videos, 25% is expected to reach internet only through mobile. This is an amazing figure and it's increasing. Flexibility is a must nowadays, not only in terms of office space, but in terms of how we work. Families are affected. And then this accelerating pace definitely puts a strain on everyone. So it's crucial to understand where we stand. Take a step behind and evaluate what we are living and try to adapt yourself in the new situation. We have to recalibrate, try to grow personally and mature personally, and to be agile. Remember this word. Agility is the word for the future. Flexibility is the meaning you should have. Agility is the word. That means if you go to your dictionary and you will see, move quickly, have the capacity to move quickly, and change easy direction if needed. Agile is a must for the future. And of course, you have to continue working with yourself, to be in a continued learning process, either on the job, either through university, either through webinars, either by combining experience with colleagues or making synergies with other companies. Let's talk a bit about the tourism industry, which is, you know, the importance, especially the people who study in the department. More, almost 10% of the world GDP, you know the importance for Greece, 240 million working there. This is an industry that has profoundly been affected by the digital revolution. Think about the travel agencies, who were the cornerstone of the travel industry since its inception. The people normally would go to the travel agent, make a hotel booking, their transportation booking, etc., etc. Now, this is happening less and less with the evolution of the booking.com and Expedia and so on. Less and less people will go there. So what they will do? If they do not respond somehow, they will die, as Brian Solis said. So, the answer there is the personal service that they can give by being there for their customer, something that the digital platform cannot do. For example, if you have a problem with an airline, if you have a problem with a hotel, the agent can still pick up the phone and try to find a solution for you. No digital operator can do that for you, at least so far. So, another factor of the change. Now the end consumer has a wealth of information in his hands. He cannot hide through internet. And the people, the managers, or the company, they believe that they can fully supply the food and such. So, and now if you combine this with citizen journalism, I referred here, which is another trend that everyone wants to be able to write his opinion, give advice, or whatever. This makes it more proud. So the client, in a way, has a control in his hands. So that's why I put respect that. It's not by accident that the big companies like Starwood spend resources to reply to every single comment to give advice, positive or negative. So more than 90% of the people, they will go to TripAdvisor to see the guest comments of the previous guests before they prepare for that. It's a great power in the hands of the guest. But this is a fact. The other fact is that the companies as well of the travel and tourism industry have a great potential in their hands because the tools they get from the technology advancements through social media, through mobile, through blogs, through forums, you name it, I read some of them there. They have a wealth of information and they are able now to know their target audience much better. So they can study their target audience and through marketing train people to focus exactly where they want to focus to get their revenues. Who could imagine 50 years back that tomorrow I want to make a campaign, for example. I want to have a campaign for French people living in the area around Paris who are between 35 and 50 years old. They have so much income per year, they are golfers, and they are male. Who could imagine that? 3 years last. Science fiction. It's happening. So the companies as well have great tools in our hands. So business is not as good anymore. So let me finish by saying also what we believe in Starwood. Because the tools are great, new tools come every day, the innovation pace is amazing. So after analyzing all the things, we believe in Starwood that the secret is the personalization. We believe that by using these tools, we should know as much as possible our customers, so we have the ability to make them feel special and recognized in every interaction they have with our hotels. And of course, this is what we do. We focus our efforts there. We use, of course, all the technology advancements. We have digital hubs around the world. We study, we analyze through our systems the information we deal, we get through these advanced technology advancements. And then we train our people to be able, and we give them the authority as well, to be able to go to the customers, which are people again, who are people again, to help them to make a personalized experience. Because we believe that it is them that we make the link with our customers. When they feel that they identify themselves inside our hotels, they will make the link and they will become repeat clients. And apparently, Starwood is doing something good if we consider that our SPG loyalty program, which is the Starwood Preferred Guest Global Loyalty Program, accounted for last year for 56% of our global sales. This is a huge strength for us. It's a growing number, and we will continue in the same focus, focusing on the needs and the likes and dislikes of our customers to make them feel this personalized experience. We believe that personalization drives the growth. This I want to tell you, and I just leave you with one, because we have young people here. We are living this age of great change. This is a historical moment, this is a historical period, and will continue for some years with new innovations, new trends. I urge everybody, be available for the change. Don't have the sentimental negativeness that you keep behind. Because sometimes we like what was happening before. It was our comfort zone. Now we have to take a step further, get out of our comfort zones, be agile, don't forget that be agile, and make a step further in order to have success for yourselves, for the companies, but most importantly for yourselves, your families, your kids, whoever has kids, because they expect from us, they expect you from your parents to make a step further for you, to give you a better and more developed world so you can carry on later on. It's challenging, I know, but believe it's about coming, and we can do it. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you very much, Mr. Petrakis. Insightful advice, especially for our student audience and younger people in the audience. And this from a man that has expertise both in image issues, his marketing expertise, and obviously operations on how to get things done. Right, I think we can have a bit of space for two or three questions perhaps from the audience.
Thank you for the truly engaging presentation. What I would like to ask is, you mentioned what a challenge it is to adjust, to change. And I would like to hear from you an example of the employees of Costa Navarino, your hotel, and how they adjusted to change, because our generation leaves the change, but you were observers and you had to get on board. So how did you do that? Was it difficult? Thank you.
Well, thank you for the question. Actually, I tried to bring this through the presentation. It has to do with the generations, of course. Okay, young people definitely has the easiness to adapt much easier because you are living with it, you are growing with it. So it's much easier. The more difficult is from people from a certain age and above, who, like myself, for example, who have been living in a previous situation, and we now lead in a company that needs to adapt the new environment. This is a challenge, this is the message I was trying to pass to people like myself, because usually you see leaders in companies like Starwood of ages above 40 or 50, even though Starwood has decreased the average age of the directors, you can see people on the 30s in the corporate office. So this is the challenge, more for these ages, that we sometimes have a tendency to step behind because it worked for us. It worked for us, and we liked it, and we succeeded there, you know. But now we have to try to find the force, the inner force to go ahead. So if you're talking about these people, of course, Navarino, I will mainly put it in the leading team of Costa Navarino, of Starwood Hotels in Costa Navarino, because in any case, the leaders would set the pace and the team has to follow after training so they will understand why they have to do that. So what we are trying to do, through the help of our headquarters, we have joined a number of seminars and trainings that we're doing in Europe and globally. This is for general managers, for the executive committees of the hotels. And based on that, we prepare then, I think, our teams internally by trying to transmit the new changes that follow the technology advancements and the new philosophies and cultures. So I think for the generic team of Costa Navarino employees, talking about from the line staff until the supervisor level, things are coming much easier because they get ready, made, let's say, the knowledge and they live with it. And they take the support from the teams. The issue is for the executive committees and above. And as I said, told you, Starwood is really trying to help to adjust all the teams globally by doing all these events, plus the webinars that we have, a lot of webinars on almost a weekly basis. And Starwood also has an intra university, as we call it. So we can we have mandatory courses we have to take to help us. Not only us, every category can have this a number of courses, but to help us to adjust and adapt quicker and help our teams to be more effective.
Have one more question.
Hello. I'm a graduate of Deree from some time ago. I found in my family something very small, which I've been managing for the last 20 odd years in tourism. And I found out that my experience says that you might have the best concept, the best hotel in the world, but if the external environment is not helping as far as the setup of the local administration, let's say, whether it's a town hall or the office of development. What I mean to say is that if there is no good destination marketing, you might be in serious trouble in the long run. Is there something you'd like to comment on?
What I can say? What can I say? What I would only say, I fully agree, especially in the short destinations like we are. Destination marketing is people power. You have to sell destination in order to sell your hotels. Especially in areas like Costa Navarino, which are new, completely areas. If you don't pick the destination, as a marketing-wise, you will not be able to sell your hotels. And we faced that in the first, especially 2 years of Costa Navarino, in great extent, because people thought we were in Spain, someone in Italy, because of Costa Navarino, you know. So, plus the airlines were not believing a destination, so if you don't have airlines flying directly to the nearby airport, how the people will arrive. So, all these things are very valid and very important. The good thing in our case is that the only company, TMS, who is the company, the Costa Navarino developers, They have a very good connection with the Messinian authorities through the late Captain Vasilis Rakopoulos, and a lot of investment in the area, and they are very supportive with the peripheral for communities as well to make it happen for Messinian. So we have seen in the last 3 years an increase in development. Right now, Kalamata Airport has an increase more than 1,000% in terms of arrivals. It's the number one airport in results, let's say, this year, in increasing results, I mean. And now they are planning to develop further, go up to make it even better, even greater, I mean. So it's absolutely true, I fully agree with you. If there is not such a chemistry with the local authorities, and especially if it's a new business like the Costa Navarino, it's a recipe to fail. You cannot go alone as a hotel or even as a big brand like Starwood to make it happen alone. We tried in the first 2 years and we suffered. We suffered ourselves. It was not enough. Definitely, you need to have the backup of and make the synergies. Nowadays, you cannot do it alone. We are living in a world that you have to make synergies with the right partners to make it happen and bring the results. One more question, I think, on the...
Thank you very much, Mr. Petrakis. Unfortunately, we cannot allow more time for questions. Hopefully, we'll explore some of them during this change of our presentations. Please don't get up. We'll go straight into our next presentation. Let me thank Mr. Petrakis again because it's been great. Thank you very much.